You know that song that goes, "On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me"? Well, have you ever wondered how many gifts that person got on the 12th day? I didn't think so. Anyways, there's a formula for that, and it looks like this. If you've seen it before, you may have seen it proven by induction, or some other algebraic proof. In this video, I want to show you how you can derive this formula from Pascal's triangle, because the technique generalizes to compute the sum of the first n squares, the sum of the first n cubes, and so on. Using these formulas, it's not too hard to calculate a sum like 1 cubed plus 2 cubed up to 100 cubed easily by hand.
If you need a refresher on Pascal's triangle, it works like this. We start with an infinite triangle of 1s. Then, we fill in each gap by summing the two entries above it, to the left and right. For instance, this should be a 2, since this 1 and this 1 make 2. Then this should be a 3, and same here. We then continue filling out the rest of the gaps in the same way. Pascal's triangle also has a conventional coordinate system. The rows are numbered, starting with row 0, then row 1, then row 2, etc. And the diagonals are also numbered, starting with diagonal 0, then diagonal 1, then diagonal 2, etc. It's kind of like a mathematical Christmas tree.
One of the most important and useful features of Pascal's triangle is that there's a simple formula for the number in the nth row and kth diagonal. The formula is based on the observation that each entry in Pascal's triangle exactly counts the number of paths to that entry, starting from the top and using only down left or down right steps. For instance, to get to this entry, starting from the top, we could take any of these paths. There are 10 paths, which matches the fact that the entry is a 10. Note that we don't allow paths that include any purely horizontal steps, like this one, or any paths that include any upward steps, like this one.
To see why the number of paths to each entry in Pascal's triangle matches that entry, first note that it works for the first few rows, just by directly counting the paths. To see it works for the next row, take this entry as an example. Every path to it either goes through this 1, or it goes through this 2. So, the number of paths to this entry is the sum of the number of paths to the 1 and the number of paths to the 2, which we already know is 1 plus 2. This same argument can be used for any other entry in the third row. Then, the same logic can be used for the fourth row, the fifth row, and so on. For instance, suppose you know that the number of paths to an entry equals that entry for all entries up to the 100th row. Take any entry in the 101st row, say this one, which by the definition of Pascal's triangle is the sum of the two entries above it. We know the number of paths to here is A, and the number of paths to here is B. The only way to get here is by taking one of the A paths and then stepping down right, or taking one of the B paths and then stepping down left. So there are A plus B paths to here, which matches the number in that entry.
Okay, hopefully you believe me that the number of paths to each entry equals that entry. Now, let's derive a formula for the number of paths. To start, notice that every path to a particular entry has the same number of leftward or rightward steps. For an example, let's look at this entry again in the fifth row, second diagonal. Every path to it contains 5 steps because it's 5 rows down, and each step is either a down right step or a down left step. To end in the second diagonal, there must be exactly 2 rightward steps, and therefore 3 leftward steps. Each of the 10 paths we saw earlier corresponds to a different ordering of the leftward and rightward steps.
So, let's generalize this for an arbitrary entry. Consider the entry in the nth row and kth diagonal of Pascal's triangle. By the same logic, each path to this entry corresponds to an ordering of k rightward steps and n-k leftward steps. These n steps can be rearranged in a line in a total of n factorial different ways. But we've overcounted. For instance, this current arrangement corresponds to the same path as this arrangement. In fact, all of the k rightward steps can be rearranged among each other and nothing changes. So we've overcounted by a factor of k factorial. Also, the n-k leftward steps can be rearranged among each other and nothing changes. So, we've overcounted by an additional factor of n-k factorial. Thus, the true number of paths to the entry in the nth row and kth diagonal is n factorial divided by k factorial times n minus k factorial. This formula is so important that it's given this special notation, which is pronounced n choose k.
Now that we have a formula for easily computing any entry of Pascal's triangle, I can address the problem posed at the beginning of the video. How many gifts were given on that fateful 12th day? Well, the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on appear right here, down the first diagonal of Pascal's triangle. To sum them, we use the defining property of the triangle. Each entry is the sum of the two above it. So, since this one is the same as this one, then this entry is the sum of the 1 and the 2. Then this entry is the 1 plus the 2 plus the 3. We keep combining terms until reaching the number we want to stop at, which is 12, and end up with a total sum of 78. Hey Nathan, why did 6 respect 70?
Why?
'Cause 78, bruh.
Why would you say-
We can generalize this technique to find the sum of positive integers up to any number n. To do so, we combine terms as before until reaching n. And the total sum is the entry down right of n. Luckily for us, we already found a formula for an arbitrary entry of Pascal's triangle. Since we're interested in the n plus first row, second diagonal, the formula yields n plus 1 choose 2. When we simplify, it reduces down to n times n plus 1 over 2. Hence, we've recovered this well-known formula from Pascal's triangle.
But as I mentioned earlier, Pascal's triangle can be used to derive formulas for the sum of kth powers of the first n positive integers, for any n and k. To see how, we'll start with the sum of squares. Say we wanted to add up 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared, and so on up to n squared. Unfortunately, these numbers don't appear directly in Pascal's triangle, but we can form them by scaling and adding together some of the entries. For instance, if we go to the fifth row, and add the number in the first diagonal, plus twice the number in the second diagonal, we get 5 plus 2 times 10, or 25. And of course, 25 is 5 squared. This isn't a mere coincidence though, as this will work for any row. If we take the 8th row, we get 8 plus 2 times 28, or 64, which is 8 squared. Thus, the sum of squares up to n is the same as the sum of the first diagonal up to the nth row, plus twice the sum of the second diagonal up to the nth row. We'll explain how we came up with this later, but for now, we'll use it to sum the squares.
We can sum the first and second diagonal in the same way as before by successively combining pairs of entries up to the nth row. Since we end up in the n plus first row, this entry is n plus 1 choose 2, and this entry is n plus 1 choose 3. Hence, the sum of the squares is n plus 1 choose 2 plus 2 times n plus 1 choose 3, which if you want, you can simplify.
Now, let's tackle the sum of cubes, 1 cubed plus 2 cubed up to n cubed. Again, these numbers don't appear directly in Pascal's triangle, so we'll try to do the same thing we did for the squares and generate the cubes as combinations of multiple entries. How do we do this? Well, notice that the third diagonal of Pascal's triangle contains terms in the form n choose 3, which is n factorial divided by 3 factorial times n minus 3 factorial. We can rewrite the numerator like this, and cancel out the n minus 3 factorials. We end up with a third degree polynomial, which can be expanded. The whole point of doing all of this is because the cubic term we're looking to sum shows up right here.
To get rid of the other junk, we need to use the first and second diagonals as well. In the nth row, the first diagonal contains the number n, and the second diagonal contains the number n choose 2, which can be simplified as before to get a half n squared minus n. What we want to do is scale and add these three expressions together so that only the n cubed term survives. In other words, what numbers can we write in these three blanks to make this equation true? Pause and give this problem a shot.
We'll start by multiplying this by 2 and this by 6 to clear the fractions. Then, to get rid of the n squared, we'll multiply this one by an additional factor of 3. Combining terms, everything except the n cubed cancels out. Thus, if we take the number in the first diagonal, plus 6 times the number in the second diagonal, plus 6 times the number in the third diagonal, we should get a perfect cube. Let's look at Pascal's triangle again and make sure our formula works. In the seventh row, 7 plus 6 times 21, plus 6 times 35 is 343, which is exactly 7 cubed. Similarly, in the ninth row, 9 plus 6 times 36 plus 6 times 84 is 729, which is 9 cubed.
Therefore, to find the sum of the cubes up to n cubed, we just need to take the sum of the first diagonal up to the nth row, plus 6 times the sum of the second diagonal up to the nth row, plus 6 times the sum of the third diagonal up to the nth row. These sums can be computed in the same way as before. Now, in the n plus first row, this entry is n plus 1 choose 2, this entry is n plus 1 choose 3, and this entry is n plus 1 choose 4. So we get this formula for the sum of the cubes, which can be simplified to n times n plus 1 over 2, all squared.
As promised, such a formula can be used to calculate the sum 1 cubed plus 2 cubed up to 100 cubed by hand. Just apply it with n equals 100. The following manipulations are simple enough to be done even in your head. But we don't have to stop there. The exact same technique can be used to find a formula for the sum of the first n kth powers for any value of k. By the same logic as before, entries in the kth diagonal take the form n choose k, which, thinking of k as fixed, is a degree k polynomial in n. Hence, these entries include the term n to the k, which is what we want to sum over. We then use the terms n, n choose 2, n choose 3, and so on, up to n choose k minus 1. To get rid of all the other junk terms, so we're only left with n to the k. Finally, we use the cascading procedure to sum up all the diagonals and obtain our formula. That formula ends up looking something like this. Well, that's the end of the script.
What do we normally say at the end of the video? Is there some greater meaning to any of this?
You're a fish.
Thanks.
Why was this video Christmas themed anyways? It's August.
Pause and give this problem a shot.
No, the video's over.
Hey Nathan, why did the fish cross the road?
Why?
To get to the other tide.
Dude, go to bed, it's 3 a.m.
Okay, fish boy.